Hi, my name is David DeLurgio. I'm a cardiac electrophysiologist with Emory University in Atlanta. I'm very happy to be part of the CAST AF program in Chicago this year. I'd like to thank Drs. Cox, McCarthy, and Knight for inviting me to talk about the Convergent Hybrid AF ablation procedure. The unmet need of persistent and AF ablation is very clearly known. Ablation procedures currently available using endocardial means are highly ineffective. Isolation of the pulmonary veins alone may only reduce arrhythmias in 41% of patients, and additional lines or targeting of electrograms only makes the outcome worse. Clearly, there's a need for better techniques. This is what drove the development of the hybrid convergent AF ablation procedure and the Converge AF trial. Shown on the right is the schema for ablation in the hybrid procedure. We use a combination of transpericardial, epicardial left atrial posterior wall ablation shown in blue, complemented by endocardial RF ablation shown in red to result in isolation of the pulmonary veins and posterior wall. The tool used is shown here. This is the epicardial ablation system. It consists of a trocar, which is flexible, and an ablation catheter, which is covered posteriorly to protect the esophagus and has a large coil electrode as well as sensing electrograms. The system also comes with a RF generator. This is a truly minimally invasive procedure involving a single incision in the subxiphoid area, creating a subxiphoid pericardial window without invasion of the pleural space and without the use of additional ports. Early experience shows this procedure to be effective with ranges of success rate in ranging from 80 to 95% and redo procedures ranging from 0 to 10%. These are single center non-randomized trials. A larger single center trial more recently confirmed this, showing ablation success with the hybrid procedure to be markedly superior to endocardial alone, with recurrence of only 37% and a redo rate less than 10% at 12 months. The Converge trial is a randomized controlled clinical trial comparing the hybrid convergent procedure to an endocardial ablation procedure. It's a 2-to-1 randomization with a total of 153 patients. We measured our primary endpoint and secondary endpoints at 12 months, and long-term data is also pending. These are the lesion sets in the trial. The right side shows the standard or control ablation. This is endocardial alone, and it involves endocardial wide area circumferential ablation of the pulmonary veins with a roofline added and a right CTI. This type of ablation of the pulmonary veins is considered standard even to this day for treatment of persistent AF. Study arm is the hybrid ablation, as I showed you, involving the epicardial posterior left atrial wall ablation and the complementary endocardial ablation. We measured our primary endpoint at 12 months. This was freedom from AT, AF, and atrial flutter absent class 1 or 3 antiarrhythmic drugs or with a previously failed dose without increase of that dose. Secondary endpoints included freedom from AF at 12 months, and burden reduction measured by a baseline Holter and a follow-up Holter at 12 months. Additional endpoints currently under analysis include freedom from drug off all our antiarrhythmic drugs and long-term freedom from arrhythmia. Safety endpoints are very important in this study, and they include cardiac tamponade, severe pulmonary vein stenosis, excessive bleeding, infarction or stroke, esophageal fistula, phrenic nerve injury, and death. We targeted a performance safety goal of less than 12%. And we realize these are important endpoints to look for given the novel nature of this procedure. This is a Kaplan-Meier curve showing the primary endpoint. At 365 days, the standard endocardial catheter ablation group was 50% free of arrhythmias, whereas 67.7% of patients receiving the convergent hybrid AF ablation procedure were free of AT, AF, or atrial flutter. This is an absolute difference of 17.7%, giving a very large relative reduction of 1/3 in our study group. This slide shows the primary endpoint in the bar graph form. The secondary endpoints are shown in the second two sets. The burden reduction is noted in the middle. 80% of patients in the study group had a greater than 90% burden reduction in their atrial fibrillation compared to 56.8% in the control group. And freedom from AF was 71% versus 51% with an absolute difference of 20%. The primary safety events are recorded here. Safety events were driven by pericardial effusions, often with tamponade shown in four patients. These are events that occur after discharge and out to 1 year. These patients typically had inflammatory type effusions related to the epicardial ablation and the inflammatory state that that produced. Some of these patients were not treated with anti-inflammatory agents. And we have learned through this experience the value of a rigid anti-inflammatory regimen for 30 days, including either NSAIDs, steroids, and or colchicine. I believe that many of these adverse events can be mitigated. I'll deviate just a little bit to give some non-controlled data from our institution. These are patients receiving the Convergent procedure commercially. We tend to use monitoring devices in all of our patients, which in the majority of patients are an implantable loop recorder, but may include a pacemaker or defibrillator capable of documenting atrial arrhythmia burden. We report on 92 patients with continuous monitoring for a mean period of 450 days. This is an example with an implanted loop recorder. At this point, you can see this patient has had continuous AFib 24/7, has the Convergent procedure, at which point there may be a little AFib noted in this patient, and then freedom from atrial fibrillation all the way out to 18 months, which is our last recorded event from this patient. It brings us up to today. During this time, you can see the improved activity level of this patient, decrease in ventricular rate, and other parameters such as improved heart rate variability that go along with maintenance of sinus rhythm. Our data looking at the 92 patients show that 94% of our patients who start with an AF burden of 100% have less than 5% AF burden out to 450 days. In other words, a greater than 95% reduction in AF burden. This, you can see there's very little change over time, showing that patients tend to have a good durable response to the hybrid AF ablation procedure. In the same patients, we see that there are some episodes of atrial arrhythmia of one type or another. 54% of patients are free from any, meaning the remaining 48% have at least one 30-second episode of atrial arrhythmia. The burden reduction is what stands out. These patients are largely free of atrial arrhythmia. We've also seen remodeling. EF tends to improve in almost every patient who has a subnormal EF at baseline, and left atrial volume decreases. These are important remodeling characteristics. These are MRIs performed in a patient with LV dysfunction the day before the hybrid procedure and 3 months later. And you can see the improvement in LV function on these MRIs and also the reduction in LA volume. Significant remodeling noted in this patient. This is another patient with functional mitral regurgitation at baseline shown here. And the two follow-up images taken at different angles show no evidence of mitral regurgitation 3 months after the ablation procedure. We've looked at LV function in a larger group of patients, and this was presented at HRS this year. It's particularly dramatic that in patients with moderate to severely reduced EF, there's a 10-point, nearly 11-point improvement in EF shown through five different centers as presented in this poster. In conclusion, we now have the results of a multi-center randomized controlled clinical trial comparing the efficacy of this procedure to standard procedure for ablation of patients with persistent atrial fibrillation. We had no limit on the duration of AFib and allowed up to 6 centimeter left atrial size, showing that we are willing to tackle a difficult to treat population. We demonstrate that the truly minimally invasive hybrid procedure has an acceptable safety profile and superior effectiveness when compared to standard ablation. And we have provided high quality, prospective, multi-center randomized controlled data to support this claim. I think this is also supported by the growing body of data from clinical experience with this procedure, which has now been performed in over 10,000 patients. And this procedure emphasizes the value of a team-based approach. And for these reasons, I believe this is the best procedure for patients with persistent or long-standing persistent AFib. Thank you.